say just a general sentence like, hey, my name is Michael Versteeg, and I just...
Hi, my name is Michael Versteeg, and I just imitated the birds as best as I could, because sometimes when I'm out in nature, I feel at one with nature when I'm a bird. So I imitate birds, because birds can fly and I can't. And I read Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach, and it changed my entire life.
I'm ready when you are, Janelle.
I am smelling like a rose that somebody gave me on my birthday. All right. You just set a new record. How are you feeling?
I feel really good. I feel all of the things wrong with me are very expected and predictable. The biggest thing I'm dealing with actually is just results from all the grass and weeds and stickers and thorns in my feet and the allergies associated with all of that, and the swelling that came with all of that, and the hundreds of cuts and slashes on my legs and feet from all the cat claw, and so it's all very superficial. And but other than that, I feel great. I'm tired, but that's again super expected and predicted. So no major issues. I feel good, and I feel like that's, you know, with something like this, it's very different than running ultras. It's very different than like expending yourself to your limit for say 24 hours or whatever. When you do something like this, you're basically approaching it from a very sustainable viewpoint and sustainable day to day. So when you actually finish, theoretically you could keep going because you've kind of hit that spot where you're just kind of moving very slowly and steadily day to day, and you're not ever actually moving super fast or so it's a very different recovery process than anything I've ever dealt with before. But I feel good. I feel fine, other than just being kind of tired.
How long has the Arizona been trail? How long has the Arizona Trail been something that's been on your radar, and that when did you conceive of the idea of running it?
So I can't say off the top of my head how long the Arizona Trail has been an official trail. That's something I should probably know. But the Arizona Trail has been something that has slowly garnered attention and like respect from people year after year, more and more so as the trail becomes kind of more official and the trail becomes sort of more developed and maintained. And still, even up until today, the trail is not fully a trail yet. I would say that as early as I've ever heard about the Arizona Trail was maybe, say, 10 years ago, when people, you know, had started, you know, doing through hikes on it and had started to, the idea of the Arizona Trail started becoming a reality, to just in the sense that you could hike from Utah to Mexico on a route that was generally non-motorized, or that was generally a trail at least. And again, that's still not 100% true today, but it's obviously excessively more true today than it was even 10 years ago. But I would say from the moment that I heard about the Arizona Trail or knew about the Arizona Trail, I knew that it was always something that I wanted to do. And that goes way back before I ever started running or ultra running or anything to do with running. And So when I started ultra running and I started getting into the competitive side of things and you know, traveling and doing a lot of these big races, I think that a lot of ultra runners kind of go through the same process as I do, and you get really excited for a few years and you get really interested. And then the races start becoming a little bit mundane and uninteresting after a while, just because you've been doing it for a few years, and you start looking towards other projects and other interesting things that you could potentially do that's outside of the racing circuit. And for me, the Arizona Trail, especially now in its current state, just became this. The last couple years especially, I would say, I really started to focus in on the idea of that it could be ran in a fastest known time attempt, because like the fastest known time for the last however long I can remember has just been basically in fast packing style, and no one had really taken the time or had taken the commitment to attempt a through run of it with a support crew and really try and do that and really try and set a true fastest known time on it. I think that has a lot to do with, and I would still potentially agree with this, is that a lot of people thought for a very long time and still do think that the trail is not totally suitable for these types of endeavors. And so, you know, a lot of the fastest known time stuff, especially, you know, with all the attention the last couple of years with the Appalachian Trail and Carl and you know, Scott Jurek and those guys going after the records on that and all the attention that's been getting, a lot of people feel with the Arizona Trail that something like that is not really possible because of the state and the condition of the trail. And even after doing it, I would say that there's a hefty amount of like support that would say that it's really not it's really not the same type of endeavor as the Pacific Crest Trail or the CDT or the Appalachia Trail or any of these long trails. That the Arizona Trail is a lot shorter, obviously, but it's, I would argue, I mean, I don't know firsthand exactly, but from what I know of the Pacific Crest Trail, the AT and the CDT, I would argue that potentially the 800 miles of the Arizona Trail is more difficult than any 800 mile stretch on any of those trails. And it's because it's not, you can't show up to the Arizona Trail just being an ultra runner or a speed hiker or whatever. It requires a lot of different skills. You know, a lot of it's route finding. You're bushwhacking through miles and miles of extremely rugged, extremely rocky and technical, extremely steep terrain. You're going through wilderness areas where trails have not been maintained for who knows how long, and only see really traffic from Arizona Trail hikers. So it's not necessarily a trail where it's, you can come in just being super fit and being able to run a certain amount of mileage per day and expect to be successful on. There's a lot of other factors that go into the Arizona Trail, and that's one thing that makes the Arizona Trail unique and special. They're rough miles, they're rough going, they take a long time to get through, and it can be really frustrating and overwhelming for a person trying to run the Arizona Trail. When you feel good physically and you're able to move and you're able to run and put down a mile, and the trail and the terrain just simply won't allow it because of the ruggedness or just because, you know, you're bushwhacking through the desert and plants in the desert. Bushwhacking in the desert is not a pleasant experience. You know, everything wants to cut you, everything wants to poke you and spike you, and all of those spikes and all of those pokes, all of those bushes have, you know, the majority of the time are coated on the spectrum from anything from an irritant to a poison, and you're like dealing with all of these things, and there's just a lot to deal with, and there's a lot of things that the Arizona Trail throws at you that none of the other trails come even close, I feel like. So, yeah, I mean, that, I figure that's just like what we're going to do, is you guys ask me a question, I'm going to blabber
on
as long as I can.
Do you have a question?
About anything.
Okay, go ahead.
Even if it has nothing to do with the question.
No, it's good. Yeah, we just want to get as much as we can, I think.
I'm just thinking about the film inside too, how I can lay it out. But can you take us to a typical day that you would go through and what that entails? Like it's from morning to night and then maybe, you know, something?
I mean, I can say yes and I can say no, because the second half of the ordeal, there wasn't really a day and a night anymore. There really wasn't a clear difference. It was all one continuous effort almost, because I was only taking 1 hour power naps, you know, at dusk and dawn. So the first half of the trail was very different, I would say, than the second half, as far as my experience went. The first half, I was still very much on just kind of the long day efforts, and then getting, you know, 4 to 5 hours of sleep every night. And so I would wake up kind of as early as possible. I would generally eat, you know, I was eating apples and peanut butter kind of right when I would wake up, and drinking a bunch of coffee. And the northern part of the trail has so much crew access that we could very much kind of easily just say, okay, crew, go down about 10 miles, go down and cook breakfast, and get all that prepared. And, you know, the couple hours it would take me to get from the start to wherever crew was, they would have breakfast made, and I would, at that 10 mile point, you know, I was generally ready to eat a big meal. And that was when I would really have breakfast and kind of do all that. And then you just kind of set out, you just kind of keep shuffling. And very early on, I realized that having too much crew access was not necessarily a good thing, because you don't actually gain a lot. And I mean, you learn this from running ultras as well, is that if you run enough ultras and you're experienced enough in them, you start to realize that when you're in aid stations, it feels like you're getting a lot out of them, but the reality of it is that you're not actually gaining a whole lot by lingering in aid stations, even though it feels really nice at the time to do that. So what I realized was that it was at a certain point, even if there was crew access at certain points, I would have to kind of ask crew to skip those points, because I was wasting a lot of time in crew stops and spending a lot of time doing whatever, you know, and washing, taking care of my feet, changing socks, and eating food, and hanging out, and talking, and thinking of anything that I could do, you know, to extend my period of time with that crew. So after that first 10 mile mark, you know, we typically go 15 to 25 miles as far as crew access went. And in that first week, I was basically, I mean, the trails up north are so much easier than they are in the central and southern sections of the trail, that I was able to cover mileage so much easier in those sections and in shorter days, you know. So there were some short days that I had up north that I remember thinking that, you know, when I was down south, like, I can't believe that I stopped, like, after 13 or 14 hours. Like, that, like, a 13 or 14 hour day seemed so short to me, just the second, like, the last week I was out there. I mean, I was pulling 20 hour days for the last, you know, 5 or 6 days, at least, I would say.
some of them were like probably 22-hour days. I mean, the last day I was out, for, you know, I don't even remember. I don't remember a lot actually, about the entire thing, especially that last 5-day push. But in the second half of the trail, I didn't have a morning. I didn't have a night. I didn't have a clear start or end to a day. The trails were so rough, and the going was so difficult. It was, you know, 1 to 2 mile per hour moving, and not because of me, not because of how I felt. I felt good. I felt like if there was ever a clear trail, I was able to move pretty well. And when I say pretty well, it was like 15-minute miles. You know, like that's great. Like 4 miles per hour, 15-minute miles while you're out there is cruising. It feels like you're running so fast. And but a lot of that terrain, I just wasn't able to do that. And I was so unprepared for the grasslands down south. I was so unprepared for it that it would suck up so much time. You know, I would run 5 minutes and then have to sit down for 15 minutes and pull everything, you know, pull hundreds of thorns out of my toes and feet and shoes and socks. And then I would run 5 minutes again and have to do it all over again. And it just got to a point where it was unbearable to move through. And, you know, my legs and feet were just getting ripped up and torn up by the cat claw that was hidden in all the weeds. And it was just, it was really, really difficult country to move through. And so what ended up happening was, instead of being able to stick to the, you know, 16, 18 hour days, I was having to all of a sudden jump up to the 20, 22 hour days and just move really slowly through this country and just power nap. So I would take a 1 hour nap at dusk, I would take a 1 hour nap at dawn, and I would just go for as long as I possibly could just to hit my quota, because I was so stubborn. I was so determined to keep it above 50 miles a day. And so basically I would, at dusk, I would take a nap, I would get up and I would do a marathon throughout the day. And then at dawn, I would take another nap, I would get up and I would do a marathon through the night. And that was basically the last 5 days, I think I did that. Which I don't even know how I did that. I didn't know I had that in me. I didn't know I had the ability to do that. I'm not sure how I did it, actually. If you were to ask me if I thought I could do it again, I would probably say no. But that was a crazy push at the end, for sure. Yeah.
Could you do like a general intro, like say your name, where you're from?
Yeah. My name's Michael Versteeg. I am from Prescott, Arizona. Currently living in Flagstaff, Arizona. And I've been running competitively for, I would say, 3 or 4 years now, and running overall for probably about the same amount of time. I've never done anything. The Arizona Trail is my first ever attempt at something in the realm of such a long multi-day run. I don't know. What else?
What do you do, or what else is your background in outdoor activities?
I currently, I've worked in construction my entire life, and amongst other things, in other fields as well. But I am currently basically just doing carpentry in Flagstaff right now, and living in Flagstaff and enjoying the kind of outdoor community and the climbing world and the running world in Flagstaff. My background kind of in outdoor sports is much more
I have much more experience coming from sort of a mountaineering background, I would say, and I've spent, you know, my entire adult life kind of traveling around the world and climbing mountains and doing a little bit of alpine style, and then in the recent, maybe last 5 years or so, I've gotten very into, you know, just kind of the straight rock climbing stuff. And so I would say I have much more experience in the outdoor world coming from more of a climbing background than I do an actual running background. So when I started running, to me, it's just, you know, all mountain sports are just variations on how to go up and down things, you know, whether it be climbing or running or skiing or whatever. And so when I started running, that's all it really was to me. It was just kind of a faster, different style of way of going up and down mountains. And so that's kind of my introduction to the sport of running. It definitely is. I didn't run in high school or college, or I didn't have any sort of background with running. But it just evolved from being outdoors and just kind of a faster way of summiting things and being outside. And it's just a different way of being outside, and running satisfies a lot of different aspects of my personality that I wasn't necessarily getting out of these other sports. So but I still do those other sports just as much, probably if not more than running. I guess I'm just not as good at those other sports as I am at running. So but again, running opens the doors to a lot of it gives the outdoor athlete a lot of possibilities when it comes to projects, I guess. I mean, you can cover so much more ground, and you can, if you're willing to up the risk factor a little bit, you can, you know, I think this morning we were talking about the Grand Teton and how I've run it, and I've also climbed it a bunch of times on some harder rock climbing routes, and it's just very different approaches to how you climb mountains. And I can say that, like, since I've started running, I've summited and climbed more mountains than ever in my life, because you can, you know, a backpacking trip that could take potentially 3 to 4 days, you know, you could do in a day if you're running. So it kind of opens the possibility if you're fit enough and strong enough to pull those things off. So that was my attraction to the sport, and that's kind of what initially got me into the sport of running. And then you kind of, you know, you meet a lot of people, and you start running races, and you start doing pretty well at races, and you kind of just snowballs, and all of a sudden, you know, you're known as a ultra runner or a trail runner, when that maybe wasn't the intent, but is good and great. So.
Can you talk about the scope and scale of the Arizona Trail compared to other big projects you've done, or trips or mountains?
I mean, there, as far as the Arizona Trail, by far is the biggest running project I've ever endeavored in. And you know, organizing a crew and all of the logistics about crew and access and, you know, supported efforts are logistical nightmares. You know, you almost feel like you're organizing an entire race just for yourself. And so I had never done anything like that. You know, the closest thing I had done to anything like that is maybe like a few day, you know, like fast packing trip where you run in and set up camp and run out of that camp or something like that. But I had never done anything that required a crew or anything like that. And so this is it. The Arizona Trail was truly my first
experience into multi-day long trail running efforts. And in a lot of ways, it completely revolutionized my thought or understanding or what I thought was endurance, whether it be endurance running or endurance sports in general. In a lot of ways, I feel like this is the first truly endurance effort I've ever undertaken. And again, it's totally skewed my interpretation of what endurance is. And like I remember saying out on the trails, you know, like things, you know, like oh, well, if you can do it in one day, like that's not endurance, you know, which is like silly, like that's not true. Like 100-mile events obviously are endurance events, but it's just a whole nother level. It's a whole nother approach. It's a whole nother mentality. Where like day after day after day after day, you're just going and going and going and going. And again, it's a completely different approach that you would have even towards 100-milers, you know, because 100-milers, you can, they're really 20, you know, obviously plus or minus, you know, a lot of time. They're, you know, they're 24-hour efforts, and you gear up for months and months and months for this one 24-hour effort, and you go out pretty hard, and you really, you know, you don't hit like starvation mode in 100-milers until pretty late into 100-milers. On something like this, like 16 days, or like, God, I can't even imagine like the guys on the AT or the PCT, like 50 days out there, like you're in starvation mode for, you know, if you're out there for 50 days, you're in that mode for 49 days, you know? And so it's pretty remarkable the amount of food you have to eat and the amount of water you have to drink when you're in that mode. And it's amazing how much even in 100-milers, like you're just totally reliant on stores off of like fats and carbohydrates that you have already stored, or hydration, you know, like everyone overhydrates the day before, you know, 100-miler, because you're drawing from that the day of the actual race. Like when you exceed that point, and every day you're waking up and you're only getting out what you put in, basically, it's a completely different phenomena, or what, like whatever you want to call it. It's a totally different approach to things every single day. And it's interesting, you know, I had never experienced anything like that before. I had never, you know, this was my first, honestly, like, this was my first time dealing with a lot of that stuff. So I'm super happy that I was able to be successful, you know, and learn so much at the same time.
Can you describe the overall, I don't know, beauty of the trail or the impact, like just traveling the whole state, what that was like?
I mean, the trail is amazing. I mean, the thing that makes the Arizona Trail super unique is, you know, the thing, and again, you ask anyone who knows about the Arizona Trail, what makes the Arizona Trail unique, and they'll probably say the same thing. And it's Arizona in a nutshell is the diversity of the Arizona Trail. So the Arizona Trail throws everything at you as far as, you know, weather is concerned, temperature, the terrain that you're running through. I mean, you're going through montane, like near alpine environments in the north. You know, you drop through the Grand Canyon, you're running through pinyon juniper and ponderosa forests, Doug fir, spruce. Like you drop down to the like kind of high Sonoran desert and pinyon juniper, you know, and And then you get to the lower Sonoran, obviously, for a long time. You're running through the high grasslands of northern Arizona. You're running through the grasslands of southern Arizona and like Patagonia and Sonoita. It's everything. And so as a person trying to attempt the Arizona Trail in one push, you have to be prepared for everything. And you see a lot on the Arizona Trail. I mean, you run through some of the most beautiful wilderness areas that, you know, the state or the country for that matter has to offer. And you see some pretty wild stuff. And, the Mazatzal Wilderness is one of the most remote wild places, I feel like, in the state. And, you know, the Superstitions, Four Peaks Wilderness, all of that. You know, the Catalinas, even though they're super close to Tucson, like, I mean, those are some wild mountains, you know, and they're big mountains. And the Sky Islands in the south, you know, the Rincons and the Huachuca mountain ranges, they're such unique environments, and they're such special places that you would never think of when you think of southern Arizona. Like montane forests up, you know, in southern Arizona. And this, you know, the whole Sky Island thing, if people don't know what Sky Islands are, they're basically ways of describing environments that are limited to grow above a certain elevation. And so we have these peaks and these mountain ranges in the desert that these environments, they can't exist below a certain elevation, so they're essentially isolated to living on tops of these mountain ranges, and they become genetically, you know, diverse, and because they're separated from other similar environments on other sky islands, so they start to very, very slowly evolve apart from each other. So each environment on top of these sky islands is actually like a unique ecological zone, like kind of unto itself, and they're very special to run through because they're called sky islands because they're essentially surrounded by a sea of desert, which they can't grow low enough into those desert zones to actually intermingle. And so when you have species, even if they're the same species, when they're separated by geography like that over certain amounts of time, they become subspecies and they start to evolve into their own kind of ecological niches, and they're super special and they're super cool to see. So running up and down over these sky islands is a really unique experience because you're in the desert and you run up and hit these sky islands and you're in these, you know, environments that are, you would just never think that were there. You would never think that there was something like that in southern Arizona. I mean, you feel like you're in high country Colorado, you know, when you're up there. And so, that's a super unique and special experience to be able to go through those zones. And also, you know, in the same run, you know, you're up in those and then a few hours later, you're back down in Saguaro Cactus and back down in the Sonora. So it's an experience you can't get anywhere else for sure. And then you run through, you know, obviously the big things. You know, there's the Mogollon Rim, there's the Grand Canyon, there's, you know, the Kaibab Plateau and all that. I mean, there's kind of all the big thing. You see a lot of the big hits in Arizona, and it's super cool to be able to do that on one trail. And, you know, not to take anything away from something like the PCT or something, you know, the Pacific Crest Trail is amazing, but it generally stays in the same type of environment, you know, that kind of high, you know, big mountain, high country environment for the whole trail. And similar with something like the Appalachian Trail, like generally speaking, you're in fairly similar territory. Not true at all with the Arizona Trail.
You talk about some of your lowest lows. Struggles.
Yeah, and the
you know, when you're out there and you're doing things like this, and you're in very vulnerable states most of the time, so you can get overwhelmed pretty easily. And so when things start going wrong, especially when they're things that are out of your control, start going wrong, you're obviously exhausted, you're obviously tired, and so you're vulnerable, and you're exerting yourself so heavily and so much every day that when something goes wrong, it's really, really hard to not let it just completely overwhelm you and overtake your entire experience. When you hit those points too, things just kind of start to snowball, you know, like all the things that you had leading up to this, like all the things in your personal life, it just all kind of snowballs at once when you start feeling like that, and it just becomes overwhelming. And so there were a lot of, you know, there were a few times out there where, like, I would have to just, I would be on the trail and I would let out these, you know, just screams, like as loud as I could. I would just be screaming on the trail because I was so frustrated and so overwhelmed and in so much pain and like not being able to move the way that I want to be able to move, and feeling like things were totally out of my control, and you know that I wasn't going to be able to do this, and I wasn't going to be able to do it in the way that I wanted to, like, and that's what's frustrating, you know, like not being able to do it the way that you want to be able to do it. But again, that's what the Arizona Trail does to you. And so you know, there were other times where I would just get so overwhelmed with things, and you know, I would just have to sit there sit calmly, just, you know, middle of the night by myself on the trail, and just tear up and like get that out a little bit and have everything, you know, and just you almost have to embrace it for the, you know, instead of fighting it, you almost have to embrace it for those 5 to 10 minutes and just almost try and exaggerate it, like try and think of every reason why you don't feel good, or every reason why you're doing this in the first place, or everything wrong in your personal life, or everything, you know, you suck it up and embrace it, and like you really let it out for those 5 to 10 minutes, and then you realize, and then you come back, you know. And the whole, all of those reasons why you're out there in the first place, you know, you start to remember them, and you just begin to push those things away again, and you just are stubborn, you just keep going, and again, none of those things were unexpected. I mean, I went into this thing knowing that I was going to find some crazy places mentally and emotionally. And it didn't, I guess it didn't fail to deliver on that end of things. But at the end of the day, I feel like those were also like really good experiences, and you know, you grow from those moments, you know. If things went right the entire time, and if things were super honky-dory the whole time, like, that's not an adventure, you know? Like, you know, the adventure starts when things are terrible, when things are super low, and you have to find a way out of it, and you have to dig and claw your way out of it, and you have to
push through that and be stubborn and just be persistent, and that's when shit is real, you know, and that's when you really find out like who you are, what you're capable of doing, and that's when like memorable experiences happen and the adventures start, you know. So I appreciate all of those moments, you know, kind of as dark and bad as they were, but I wouldn't, that's part of it, and I wouldn't trade them in, because they were a part of the process, you know, they were a part of the experience, and a super crucial and important part of the experience of the Arizona Trail. So as much as you know, at the time, as when you're going through that stuff, you know, it probably would have been nice if everything was just perfect and going super well, but you know, in hindsight, I can look back on those times of the Arizona Trail and appreciate them, I guess.
Can you talk about some of the high times or the really memorable, great moments?
Yeah, it's funny, like with these types of things, you spend so much time kind of in physical pain or just kind of uncomfortableness, you know, and so, you know, anyone who's ever run an ultra marathon, I think kind of knows what I'm talking about, is you spend so much time kind of, you know, you don't feel the great, you know, and you're just kind of pushing through, and you know, every morning I would wake up and it would just be the or every time I would wake up in general, whatever, I don't, you know, it wasn't morning most of the time, but it would be so hard to wake up and just, you're just like, just so difficult to move every time you would wake up, because, you know, you've only had a couple hours of sleep and you've been running 50-mile days, and you have to get up and start the clock over at zero and have to run another 50 miles, and your body just, it just does not want to get up. And it's weird. So like you spend so much of your time feeling like this, just forcing yourself to keep moving and get up and hit your mileage and hit your pace and all of these things. And then sometimes out of nowhere for like 10 to 15 mile stretches, just like 3, 4, 5 hours, you just hit these moments of euphoria where you're just like, everything is firing, like your body is functioning, like for whatever reason all the pain that you've been feeling or dealing with for the last few days is, it just kind of numbs up and goes away, and like, and the trail finally clears and you're able to like move how you want to be moving on the trail. And you would just hit these little windows of euphoria where you're proud of yourself, you know, for what you're doing, and the weight of the whole entire project, like the gravity of the whole thing kind of sinks in. It's like, oh, I'm really doing it, like this is really gonna happen, I'm gonna succeed. And you know, again, anyone who's run an ultra, I think, understands the idea between the really high highs and the really low lows. And I would say, because this is basically just an exaggerated version of a long ultra marathon, those really high highs and really low lows were just exaggerated probably in the same way. So there were some days where I was just ecstatic, you know, and really proud of myself and really happy with what I was doing and actually able to like enjoy my surroundings, And those were really special moments as well, you know. I mean, running through the Grand Canyon, even though I've done it, you know, a dozen times, it's like doing that, everything was a little bit more special when it's placed in the middle of a project like this, you know. So every run, every section, every passage was a little bit more special when you're doing it as a whole of the Arizona Trail versus as broken up segments. So it was very much a, you know, the sum was much greater, the whole was much greater than the sum of its parts with the Arizona Trail. So there's a lot to be said about that, about the happiness and joy that I got from the project and as a whole and completing the entire thing. And I guess that's a lot of post feelings as well, you know. Just, you know, I had never understood suffering or pain or low dark moments. I had never understood quite that level until now, but also what comes from that is a sense of accomplishment and like gratification, and I can say that it's that some of the things I did out there were truly some of the first times where I feel like I can say it without too much ego, was that I really am proud of myself for being able to pull some of those things off, especially in those last 5 days. So that's something new for me, to actually just be able to walk away and humbly say that I am proud of myself, and not, you know, clarifying it or qualifying that statement with a whole bunch of things. Like, that's pretty big for me, I think.
Can you just get a soundbite of basically saying, my name is Michael Versteeg, and like the FPT, my year at the FPT in the Arizona Trail was time. What do you think? Is a soundbite just to have it? Can you do that?
Yeah. My name is Michael Versteeg. I just ran the Arizona Trail in a new fastest known time of 15 days, 22 hours and 39 minutes. Besting the previous time by anonymous Adam Bradley of 21 days and 14 hours or something like that.
Talk about what you were feeling as that obelisk came into sight. And like,
yeah, I really wanted to have the really big emotional, you know, like happy moment at the border, reaching that obelisk and, you know, having very much a like hard rock kissing the rock moment where everyone's happy and cheering. And I think by the time that I had finally actually reached the obelisk, and, you know, we had kind of gathered the crew, and the crew ran the last mile and a half with me down to the border and down to the obelisk. So there was, you know, five of us down there. And I think we were all so tired and so overwhelmed with stuff that it was very much of like, okay, we're done. Like, we're here. Let's all lay down and just go to sleep type of a thing. It wasn't quite the whole like grand, like, okay, I'm done. Like, it definitely felt great to be done. I think I was happier to not have to run in the grasslands anymore than I was to actually finish the Arizona Trail. So I might have been happier about that. I was extremely, it was never, what's interesting throughout all of this was that I never thought I wasn't going to do it. The thought never crossed my mind in the whole 16 days that I wasn't going to finish. Like, I never once thought seriously about stopping or quitting, which is kind of amazing. I'm not really sure why, because that's all I think about when I run races a lot of the times, like especially 100 milers. I'm just like constantly trying to convince myself that I shouldn't quit.
Which was interesting. I didn't have that at all in this project. I knew I was going to finish. I knew I was going to do it. It was just a matter of, and I also knew I was going to get the record. Like I never cared about the record. The record was there for the taking, for whoever actually committed to the Arizona Trail and took the time out of their year and got a crew together and did all the logistics and actually set out for a true run style of the Arizona Trail. The record was kind of there for the taking. Like, you really only had to do 40 miles a day to break the record. Even less than that. I mean, it's like 38 miles a day or something to break the record. So it was kind of there for the taking for the first person to actually do it. So that record was never really on my mind. It was never really there. It never drove me. If anything, it did the opposite. Like, there were people who would come out to the trail and they would say things like, "Oh man, you're so far ahead of the record. You should take it easy. Like, you're pushing it too hard." And those statements would just send me into a fury. I could not at the time. I remember not being able to deal with those kinds of comments. Or crew would recommend that I should rest or I should get more sleep, because I was committed to going under 16 days and I wanted under 16 days so bad from the beginning. And I mean, from the get-go, from you know, planning, scheduling before I even started the Arizona Trail, like the manual that I sent out to all the crew and pacers, you know, it had 16 days on it and 50 miles a day, and I wanted to make sure I got that, and I wanted to make sure I hit that. So, like, that was the driving force for me. Like, it didn't have much to do with the record. It didn't have much to do with anything else other than the fact that I had personally set out to run the trail in under 16 days and hit 50 miles a day, which is pretty crazy, because in a time window for 16 days, to come in about an hour and a half under that over an 800 mile run. I'm pretty happy about that. I don't even remember what the question was.
Yeah, nada.
I think I got enough unless you have some more questions. Almost 52 minutes right now.
Right. What else do you want to say?
I think I wanted to get on film or somewhere, just about like I haven't really talked about the grass,
okay.
Or the weeds, you know.
Talk about it.
Like, not even a rant. I just feel like. Like, people ask me before the Arizona Trail, and people have asked me after and even during, what the hardest part of the Arizona Trail was. And if you had asked me before the Arizona Trail, I would have never guessed that the grasses in the southern half of the trail were going to be the hardest part of the trail. When I run 800 miles in 16 days, that was like the easiest part about it. Like, everyone understands that it was difficult to do that. It's difficult to run 50 miles a day and to keep that pace up for 16 days, or for God, like, you know, 42 days on the Appalachian Trail, or for 50 days on the Pacific Crest Trail. That those kinds of things are impressive, but with the Arizona Trail, that is not the most impressive thing. The distance of 800 miles. The impressive thing is being able to keep up 50 miles a day through the terrain and through the issues that I was dealing with. And the grasses in the south were some of the worst trail experiences that I had ever experienced. And I'm not blaming it on anybody else. I was totally unprepared for those grasslands. I'm running through, you know, waist to chest high grasses, completely overgrown on the trail. So there's, underneath all of these grasses, there's a trail somewhere. and you're basically just bushwhacking through these grasses. And every 20 to 30 feet, there's just giant cat claw overgrowing the trails in every direction, and you can't see them because of the grasses. And so when you're running around in running shoes and little short shorts, and you're trying to get through this material, and your legs would just get completely torn up by the cat claw. So I had like 10 different layers of just like slashes and cuts all over my legs trying to get through this like bushwhacking segments. And then this grass is also I don't know if it just is a mild like allergen, or it was just me personally from being in it for like 16 hours a day and it having rubbing all over my legs and feet. And so what was happening, because I had open wounds basically all over my legs from the cat claw, the grasses were like whatever mild irritant or oil that was getting in there was like getting into my blood in my legs. And so some nights I was coming in to camp and my legs would just be like covered in blood, and all of the scratches would just be a little bit oozy, and my legs would be so swollen like tree stumps, and it was like insane and just so overwhelming, and I didn't know like what to do about it or how to deal with it. And then the thorns, all the little stickers and everything would just go right through my shoes and socks, and they would get into my feet and my toes, and they would just, I mean, I still, like today, I'm pushing out and pulling out like so many thorns and little things out of my feet and legs. And so they started getting into my toes, and because I, at a certain point, I couldn't stop for 15 to 20 minutes every 5 minutes and pull these things out, I was just having to run through these sections just to get through the country in severe pain. It was like having 30 needles like digging into your toes and feet while you're trying to run through this terrain. And what happened was all of those little needles started creating all these little bumps and irritation and rashes on my feet. And since they were mildly allergic to them, my feet started to swell, and they started to not fit in my shoes very well. So I started getting hot spots. And then that night or the next day, we had decided, because I really didn't have a good booty system or really wasn't prepared for it at all, the only thing we could do at that time was to kind of wrap my entire shoes and make these crazy knee-high booties out of duct tape and just move, just so I can move through the country and get through it. And what was happening was that it was causing my feet were just completely unable to breathe for like 12 hours a day. So they were in really, really wet, sweaty conditions. So I had like the last few days of the trip, I went, I think, 11 days on the first 11 days on the Arizona Trail where I had zero issues with my feet. They were perfect. They were like zero blisters, zero anything, zero problems at all. To within just fast forward a couple days, and I had swollen, bumpy, rashy feet from this grass. And then you combine that with being in a really, really wet environment for like 12 to 14 hours, and I just started getting blisters, and my feet just totally fell apart the last couple days. Toward the last day or two, it was really, really painful to run on, and I can't even believe like what happened with the grasses and all the things I was dealing with. And I so much rather would have preferred to run up and down, the Superstitions or the Catalinas all day long on really steep rocky trails, because there was at least trails and I at least wasn't in the grasses. And it was frustrating too, because a lot of these segments where the grasses were in the generally flat terrain, and where you're supposed to be able to make up pace and make up mileage and get your pace back up, I was moving 1 mile per hour through some of the stuff, through some of the really bad stuff. And that's what essentially forced me into doing the 20 to 22 hour days there at the end, just because it was such slow moving and I was
having such a hard time with everything. Yeah, I guess that's...
That feel good.
I wanted to say that.
Do you have any, like, thank yous for sponsors or other things you want to say? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, so given that it was a supported effort, I feel so indebted to so many people for extending themselves for me, especially the crew. I mean, there were... The crew was so huge. Tyler and, you know, Jamil and Josh and Brian, Dave and Jean and Tony, Paco, you know, like, the crew leads, I feel so indebted to them, how much work they did. It's really hard crewing. It's hard work, and it's, you know, it can be unfulfilling because, you know, a person like me who's just stressed and vulnerable can come through and just be a total asshole. And they're working so hard and they're doing so much, and I can't say enough to the crew and all of those guys, and to anyone who came out and paced or crew helped crew or filmed or did anything. I thank all of those people so much. Squirrel's Nut Butter, I think, saved my life. I literally, it was one of the most important things I had out there on a day-to-day basis, and I would have nightmares at night thinking that I had left my Squirrel's Nut Butter behind. It was so crucial on something like this. And I'm like, Run Steep Get High and Air Viper Running, and like, they've been such a huge support for this project. And Solomon, Darn Tough, again, totally supportive of everything that I'm doing. The Hike Shack in Prescott has been so supportive of me for years, and this was no different. They came through huge. Like, Huppy Bar and Flagstaff came through huge. They were a huge support. Fire Creek Coffee, like, got on board, and, you know, I can't even tell you how many pounds of coffee we went through between me and the crew. It was all so appreciated, and it was all so crucial. Like, I really, every company that got involved, every person that got involved was so huge, and I can't thank them enough. It was, you know, I feel so humbled and I'm so appreciative of all of those things that I get to, you know, do these crazy sorts of things, and then also have support from my friends and community and, you know, sponsors that I feel really special, and I can't say thank you enough, for sure.
You need to touch on your diet.
My diet is way better than anyone else's diet. The way I eat, the things I eat are better than what anyone else eats. No one understands diet like I do. The things I eat and the things that I put in my body make me a better person than other people. Because they put different things in their body, and it's what enables me to do the things that I do. Now, I think people who argue about diet are really silly. I think that diets work for individuals, and if you find a diet that works for you and that you're successful on, that you should continue to do that. I think the human body is an amazing thing, and I think that the human body evolves or adapts to what you give it in order to be the most functional and most efficient that it can. So I would say that if you're worried about diet, I would say generally, you know, like, if food is good for you, you should eat. You'll live longer if you eat food than if you don't eat food. And other than that, you know, there are obvious things, like, you probably shouldn't eat at McDonald's every night, but
like, they're obvious things, you know, eat good food, eat fresh food, eat diverse food, and your body will adapt and be super efficient to processing that food that you give it on a regular basis. And so if you just stick with kind of what you're good at and what works for you, I would say that that's great. And I know a lot of people think that I have a really, really terrible diet. And I would say that sometimes that's absolutely true, but I also have a very diverse diet. And I think that that is probably the best thing that anyone can do for themselves is to have diversity in their food. I think exercise is more important too than diet, but that's just me personally.
Anything else? I think I'm good.
Yeah, I think we're good.
You good?
Yeah.
Any final, last chance?
I think so. I don't know. I really look forward to, I think that, you know, when somebody does something like this, especially for the first time, you know, it garners some attention, and I really look forward and hope that, you know, some other people go after it next year, and I really look forward to other people getting after it and trying to best my time, and I'll be fully supportive, whether it be, you know, through you know, just good thoughts, or if I can actually be there and help crew and support whoever's doing it, I would love to be a part of it. So I think that, like I said earlier, a lot of people were unsure if the Arizona Trail was fit for speed record attempts, and I think I've shown that it can be done even in the current state of the trail. And you know, as the years go by, the trail's going to get better and better and more maintained and easier, essentially. So I have no, you know, I have no misconceptions that this record is going to last for very long. I have every bit of confidence in that somebody else has the ability to do it much faster. And you know, as the trail gets better, that'll be easier. And so the record certainly is going to fall probably fairly soon, the more people that go after it and as conditions get better on the trail. But I look forward to watching all of that and seeing all of that. So good luck to anyone who, I hope that this, you know, inspires some people to go after the Arizona Trail, and hope the Arizona Trail becomes a popular, you know, in the same vein as something like the Colorado Trail. So and it has the potential absolutely to be a top-notch trail like that. So
plea to Red Bull.
So I'm plea to Red Bull. So like I said earlier, I think Carl had a six-figure budget for the Appalachia Trail, so I'm currently accepting anywhere from the $50,000 to $100,000 budget for anyone who wants me to go after anything. Anyone who, so Red Bull, if you're listening, I'll drink. I don't know if I'll drink five a day, but I'll drink four a day, probably, maybe five. If you $75,000, PCT. I'll do the Colorado Trail for $30,000, and a masseuse, Swedish.
And any last thoughts about Shania?
Oh yeah, I didn't say anything about Shania. So basically the one thing that kept me moving the entire 800 miles, all the times, you know, that I was just in the dumps and was just suffering and just super tired, I honestly believed that if I accomplished and finished the Arizona Trail, that Shania Twain would hear about it and I would have his shot. I think I have a shot. And she would, you know, maybe, just maybe, she would respect me enough and she would see this and, you know, I could just ask her to marry me. That's all I want. That's not such a big deal, I don't think. And I think she's be open to the idea. I think that I have a shot. And so that's what kept me going, knowing that if I finished the 800 miles in under 16 days, that I would potentially be married to Shania Twain. So if anyone can help with that, I'm looking at you, Ellen DeGeneres and Oprah Winfrey.
If anybody out there hears this and can make that happen, that would be greatly appreciated, and I'll forever be in debt to you.
Do you want to say anything directly to Shania if she's watching?
If Shania is watching right now, Shania, I want you to know that I've already bought you a brand new Pendleton jacket, and if this doesn't work out, Shania, basically next year I'm doing a fastest known time attempt south to north on the CDT, ending in Canada, where I want you to be at the finish on the Canadian border, where the CDT goes past Canada, doesn't it? Whatever. Somewhere in Canada, just meet me and just ride a steer in, and I'll meet you there with a bottle of Pendleton and or Canadian Club. What do they drink in Canada? Whale blubber. And I will love you. I'll love you till the day you die. You're still the one, Shania. You always have been. You're still the one I run to. The one that I belong to. Still the one I kiss goodnight. I love you, Shania. Hashtag Shania Versteeg.
Okay, yeah, good. All right, that's a wrap.
That's a wrap.